a very important one, because if you committed hubris, then the gods would punish you. And to come from Sweden or France or anywhere and to talk about policy options for Cyprus is obviously a grave case of hubris. But I hope the organizers have a good contact with the gods, so that they will help me out in the future. I'm asked to do this presentation in two parts. For first part, a rather long part, was really about geopolitical changes, and then I come to the title of my intervention. So I will talk a little about the European geopolitical changes that we can see. For a long time ago, there was the first French movie, The Sound, and it's about Cardinal Richelieu, you know, the one that she would see musketeers of Dumas. And the Cardinal is in his office, and there is a messenger coming in to see him say, "Sir, you know, the 30 years war has just started." Well, they could obviously not know that at the time, because they couldn't know that until 1648, when the war ended after 30 years. And that shows that at a certain moment, like our moment now, you can never, because you know that you are in a process, but you have no real idea at all to know where that process will take you. But anyway, there are a lot of people believe that we are in now for major geopolitical changes. Another example how difficult it is to see into the future is the financial crisis. I'm not a financial man, for God's sake. I'll go back to the banker who takes that care of that. But anyway, I understand that the first warnings of the financial crisis came in 1999, really. And in 2007, there were important signs of approaching financial crisis. It was not until 2008 that it was everyone had accepted that we now are in a crisis and started to do something about it. Spring 2009, that's half a year ago, at least in French papers, you could say that now, you know, financial crisis and the sort of financial system will have to end. This is the end of market economy. And today, I don't hear many people saying that this is the end of the market economy. So we can learn that first, it takes a long time to react to changes. And then when you do it, you have a tendency also, of course, to take foregone conclusions of what is happening. But it's financial crisis has shown something perhaps more important. If it had happened 5-6 years ago, probably it had been the G7 or G8 who had been asked to handle this crisis. But this time it was the G20. So the old powers could not handle this themselves. They had to bring in the new powers. And I think that's very important, the starting point, so to say, from my speech. Firstly, we ourselves, we belong to an aging Europe. And I believe that we will have to cede power to the new powers, to China, of course, to Brazil, to India. Of course, Europe is certainly continue to be an important player, and the new Lisbon Treaty gives hope for a better, more concerted policy. But on the other hand, I must admit that our first real president doesn't seem to be too appreciated, and no one really believes that he will take giant steps forward for the European Union. I think also it's a fact that today that too many European leaders they prioritize you know, the national or party politics, short-sighted, instead of concentrating on the more long-term affairs. And I believe also that the future Europeans will have to pay for that. As Maria talked, we have now released to the Lisbon Treaty, and you might know, and you know of course, that in the Lisbon Treaty we had a paragraph 42.7 about defense that basically says that when a European member state is attacked, everybody else should help that country as much as possible. There are some caveats, of course. So that effect, Sweden has made a declaration of solidarity, which sounds like this, my own translation. Sweden will not be passive in the case of a catastrophe or an attack against another EU member or a Nordic country. We expect other countries to act in the same way if Sweden is a victim. So there is now a notion of European defense, even among us who are not members of NATO, because Sweden is not members of NATO, member of NATO, as you know, and will not be it in the future either, I believe. NATO, for its sake, I think the future NATO is in some doubt. It has clearly staged its future on Afghanistan, and I think that chances are that we lose. Next spring, they will present a new strategic concept. We don't know too much about it. We don't belong to NATO. But anyway, there must strike a balance between those who prefer, let's say, an old-fashioned NATO, collective defense and Article 5, and those who prefer a new NATO, concentrating on crisis management operations. How this will result, I don't know, but one could imagine that there will be some tensions within NATO. And of course, NATO must also try to tell how they are going to realize the strategic partnership between NATO and the European Union, and there, of course, Turkey and Cyprus have important roles. We can never talk about geopolitics without talking about the United States. It is, of course, still a superpower in the military sense, but on the other hand, the military is clearly overstretched, and it has an enormous budget deficit. And you know also that this budget, they have loaned them borrowed their money mainly from China, which is interesting from a geopolitical point of view. So, and then also the United States need, I believe, to rebuild the confidence and trust in its policies after the Bush era. That will not be easy. And if Obama is really the man who we hoped him to be, that is not quite clear. China is, of course, clearly becoming a world power, that everybody knows that. And then one interesting thing, because maybe it might not be so well known, is that in the 15th century, China, the Chinese Navy made important, very big operations into the Indian Ocean. But then the emperor decided, and his courtiers decided that no, we shouldn't do that. So they scrapped their navy and then stayed within China's boundaries. And at the same time as China gave up these ideas, the Portuguese are coming around the horn, the Cap Horn, and then the European, the era of European colonies starts. So you can see the Chinese were there, they leave, the Europeans come in, now we have left, and now the Chinese are back. I mean, they are now patrolling in the Indian Ocean together with the Russian naval ships, together with NATO naval ships, and the EU operations. I think that is a rather interesting illustration of the change of structure of world power. China is also, you know, a very important investor in Africa. It has been charged by colonialism. There was, I think, six Chinese workers who were beheaded in Algeria a month ago. So they might have some problems with that policy. But the problem for us, of course, is that China, as they don't want to interfere in internal affairs of states, they in that way make troubles for our policy to try to spread democracies, good governments, and human rights in Africa. All that being said, of course, we all also know that China has enormous economic problem, social problems, and environmental problems, and of course, there is also possibilities for major troubles in Thailand. We don't know. As I said, we are in the process, we don't know about. The role of Russia, there is almost a lot, but I skip this paragraph because the Professor Abbotova will say everything about that. But what will be the role of Russia in the future? I think that jury is very much out. Will it come back, be a great power, a good great power, or will it decline? And then again, the jury is still out. And it's clear that we live around the Baltic Sea, we will always, for historical reasons, be afraid of Russia. Either we will be afraid because Russia is too strong or because Russia is too weak. In the same way, I suppose, as you will always be, in one way or another, afraid of Turkey. So that's some lines. Then we should look into this arc of crisis. You know, the idea of arc of crisis, they come from a man whose name is very difficult to say, Cyprus, who was security advisor to President Carter. And the idea of the arc of crisis then, which was, you know, this part of the world, came up after the fall of the Shah. Now that the idea of arc of crisis come back in the French White Book from 2008. And this time, the arc is stretching from the west of the map to the right of the map. So it goes on from West Africa to North Africa towards Pakistan and Central Asia. And all this area is characterized, among other things, by a very quick increase of populations. Believe that the populations will double until 2030. They also have important sources of oil and gas, as you know, but they mainly lack other natural resources. In particular, they lack potable water. And as with climate change, this situation that will be aggravated. And so you cannot you must count with that there will be important migrations from this area with possible conflicts in their way. At the same time, this whole area is characterized by tensions in societies. There are alien leaders, there are fragile regimes, fragile economies. There are tensions between the moderate and the radical Islam, between Shia and Sunni, and the threat from Al-Qaeda. We also have a long number of ongoing conflicts. India-Pakistan, for instance, of course, in Pakistan, Afghanistan, of course, which I just talked about, Iraq, and so on. And we, of course, the eternal conflict in the Middle East, the Palestine and Israel issue. And one of the most worrying things is that Pakistan, a very fragile country, is now a country with nuclear weapons. And I understand that we will see Iran also with nuclear weapons in some time. And that, as a consequence, will put enormous pressure on the whole area, as there's a big risk for proliferations of weapons of mass destructions in the area. And of course, the Mediterranean, it's obvious from the map, plays a very crucial role in this area. It's the Mediterranean that links the Atlantic through the Black Sea and through the Red Sea to Asia. In this area, 25% of world trade is passing, and a very large amount of energy goes there. It is also an important link for better worth between Europe and North Africa. And we have now what we talked about this morning, the recent findings of oil and gas in your area here, which will make that even much more important. So from the geopolitical view, the Cyprus and, of course, Turkey will play a very important role. On quite another angle, there's another change which I believe at least affects us in the West, and that there's a possible death of the national state. As you know, the national state has been the backbone of the international systems since 1648, and we are used that international politics is something as state-to-state policy. But this may not be true in the future. Western states, for instance, we do not make wars or crisis management operations, as we call it, sounds much better, alone anymore. We always do them in coalition. We do them in the United Nations, with EU, with NATO, or perhaps coalitions of the building. And the objective of today is not, of course, conquering territories, but conquering hearts and minds create stability and so on. But and the enemy, if one may call it that, is normally not a non-state actor. It's groupings of different sides. But also on our side, you see in the proliferation of non-state actors. We have, of course, all the multinational industries. And what we just talked about before lunch on the role of these big oil companies, in which really is a political role, as it was described by my predecessor here, is, of course, a sign of this. And then we have the NGOs. You know, in Afghanistan today, there are about 100 big and 1,000 small NGOs, everybody catching for their interest. And on top of that, we have the increased use of so-called private military enterprises, so which are, of course, a reminiscence of Europe in the Middle Ages. All Western states also have important groups of immigrants, regardless of where we will do a conflict management or crisis management operation. The enemy in that area, the enemy to stability, will have families, friends, followers in our countries. And then they will then perhaps help, our enemy. And they can do that, of course, like in Madrid in 2004, by making terrorist attack, but more benign through this possibility of destabilizing information campaigns. And information war, the information society is, of course, immense significance. There are more than 1 billion internet users in the world. And the use of social media, you know, the blogs, the Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook, and I don't know what, may have a great political impact. You know, it is said that if you want to know the foreign policy of Sweden, you cannot read that on the homepage of the foreign minister, you have to go to the blog of Carl Bildt. I don't know if it's true, but it's said that. And to a large extent, this of course is good. It was shown during, for instance, the demonstrations in Iran this summer. We have probably not been able to follow that so much if these new information media had not existed. On the other hand, there is a risk that people, so to say, instead of reading old-fashioned newspapers where they can have different views, which can enhance the democratic debate, they just follow the media, which give them the message that they themselves believe in, and then the debate will be narrower. And you should, of course, not also forget that the internet and blogs and all these things are rather easy to manipulate. And in some all these developments, they lead to some kind of fragmentation of the old state and an increasing number of international actors. That does not mean, of course, that the nation state completely will disappear. That will take a long time, if ever. And also old-fashioned wars between states are not totally dead either, but witnessed by the war between Georgia and Russia for whatever reason that war would happen. But it was a war, clearly an old-fashioned war in that sense that it was a war between two states. Now I'm shifting to something which is very important for us in the European Union and should be important for all. And that is the integrated maritime policy. Someone has said that the 21st century will be maritime, or it will not be. Exactly how that would be, I wouldn't know, but it's a catching phrase. And in fact, the Commission, European Commission, is called Blue Book on a European Integrated Maritime Policy, has written like this: the seas are Europe's lifeblood. Europe's maritime spaces and its coasts are central to its well-being and prosperity. They are Europe's trade routes, climate regulator, source of food, energy, and resources, and a favorite site for citizens, residents, and recreation. And one of the particular goals that European Union is now pursuing is the idea of the motorways of the sea. We have to take out the transport from our congested roads, as the intra-European Union freight transport is thought to increase with 70% in the next years. And as I see it, when I look down on one of the major motorways, the one through the Mont Blanc tunnel, I can say that it is congested. It will not take another 70% of lorries. There are this blue line shows present plans for these motorways. And it is hoped then that this could be a system which is give a very good service, which could be safe and environmental friendly. So, and of course this will be of importance for Cyprus, which is a major maritime country. So, finally we come to policy options for Cyprus again with these backgrounds. And as Dr. Strömvik said, I can't say that we have a Western strategy. Strategic theory is my specialty, I would say, and I can't see a European strategy, a Western EU strategy. There are, of course, a number of goals, development, the ECP, cooperation in NATO, and so on and so forth, but they are not a real strategy. But anyway, one could discuss Cyprus. So let's look at Cyprus. Cyprus has both advantages and drawbacks. And I'm asked to be quite blunt now. First of all, its geostrategic location. It was discussed before from the energy sector. It was played an important role for basing, among other things, of Swedish naval forces during the operation outside Lebanon after the war in 2006. There are presidents of some kind of naval and air force base rights here since 2007 and so on. Cyprus is also an EU member. It participates in the ESDP. It has representatives in the European Union military staff, military committee. It has taken part in a number of operations. It's a part of a battle group and so on. Cyprus also is a former colony, and that is rather alone in Europe. I suppose it's only Ireland that considers itself as a former colony. And that means that Cyprus will have particular credibility towards other former colonies, and particularly, of course, more credibility with some European great powers which all have colonial past. And again, Cyprus has an important shipping industry. But then look at the disadvantages, the cons. I'd say that Cyprus could be characterized as a consumer of security. That's probably unfair, but that was what you think when before you start looking into all the problems. It's obviously a divided country. You have there are UN troops here that should be needed elsewhere. You have also. We don't need to discuss the reason, but there are bad relations with Turkey. And Turkey is geopolitically and geostrategically as an important for Europe as Cyprus. And it also Cyprus tends to impede Europe's activities against towards Turkey when we try to give them carrots in order to make them stable and democratic country. And there is a feeling that Cyprus is not really helpful in this area. And as a consequence, of course, of this problem, Cyprus is not a member of PFP. Cyprus has not a security agreement with NATO. And that means that the so-called Berlin Plus agreement of cooperation between EU and NATO cannot work. That reduces effectiveness of the ESDP and the reason to a lot of difficulties in relation between organizations. I know that first time I was in the EU military staff in the beginning of 2003. And I remember when we had discussions with NATO, we had to put on civilian clothes and go on to a restaurant because the Turkish ambassador would immediately say stop if you saw Sweden out there and trade. So there are a number of problems with Cyprus. There is also a tendency, I understand, that if Cyprus uses its membership more to foster its own special ideas against Turkey, against also UK and the United States, instead of working for the common good. Of course, all states work for their own interests, but there are kind of limits here. So, what should Cyprus do? Again, UBIS, but that's my mission. I know that there are negotiations between North and South on Cyprus, and I have no inclination of saying anything about that because it's much more complicated. So we just discussed. There are obviously two, I understand there are two possible outcomes. There is a reconciliation or it is not. And there is a number of these things that Cyprus might do. Some of them might not be possible depending on the outcome of these negotiations. But anyway, I will try to come up with a short list now. So the first, the global policy must be that Cyprus gets itself a trademark or a producer of security. Strives to be helpful in organizations where it takes part. So it should use its EU membership to further European interests in a much higher sense than today. And I think today, with the European defense and so on, Cyprus should be able to feel more secure in its relations with Turkey. Oh, Turkey would handle this, but obviously you have no idea. The UN troops on Cyprus should of course be sent away to Africa where there's a need for them. When it is possible, because I know that this is again a problem in Turkey, as it is possible, Cyprus should join the Partnership for Peace. I don't say that Cyprus should become a member of NATO. And Sweden is not a member of NATO, I regret it, but we are not. And I understand that the history of Cyprus will not allow it to become a member of NATO for a very long time. It doesn't matter, look at the Irish. I can't imagine Ireland ever becoming a member of NATO, but they are a member of Partnership for Peace. Because that's the way to develop a partnership program, that's the way to increasing the interoperability of your security forces, and as I say, that, because you can say what you want about NATO, but it is NATO which is the main provider of military tools in Europe. We all use NATO books, we all use NATO standards, the so-called standards, we use NATO doctrines and so on. And that is the international standard today, the way NATO does it. So that is something very important. And you must, of course, get a security agreement with NATO, because otherwise, as long as there's no security agreement, NATO is not able to give a number of important information to the European Union. And of course, most members of the European Union are members of NATO, so most countries will get this information anyway, but as a NATO member. But the European Union has an organization in that country. And we, for instance, the Swedes, will not get it. It is a problem for us. Furthermore, one could imagine that Cyprus would be very active in ESDC, the European Security and Defense College. You should start a crash program to educate civil servants and military in NATO affairs. Send them someone to NATO Defense College to shape school in Abramba. And then another big problem, and I don't know, I understand many other things, but disarmament, because I understand that there is an idea that if there is a reconciliation, Cyprus has to disarm. And of course, I really can't understand that, because Cyprus as a sovereign nation must of course have the means to defend its sovereignty and its interests. The place where Cyprus is situated means that it's very, very important that Cyprus has, if not an air force, at least an air patrol, it must have at least have an armed coast guard, and need of course have some security forces. But you can call that what you want. Japan has a very huge army, but it's taking, you know, they have self-defense forces. But they look very much like that. So there are perhaps possibilities here.
But the Ministry of Defense since 2006, because I was just there on the interface.
Oh, good. So I just said that disarmament should not be an option. And then Cyprus should use all its advantages, the relations with Middle East countries, with North African states, and to facilitate Barcelona process, He should be, of course, be an active player in the integrated maritime policy and pursue policy of secure, safe, and environmental friendly shipping. And why not? Maybe that's because I don't know that exists one. But why not kind of central excellence for safe and environmental friendly in Cyprus for Mediterranean country? Something like that. And its strategic location should be used also as a cornerstone in the upcoming European maritime surveillance system, which is now starting. And if we could have such, Europe could have, it is a perfect place, of course, to anchor the eastern wing of an integrated European maritime surveillance system. The negotiations with your northern parties are not possible, they cannot give a possible solution. Why we don't need to discuss, and I won't discuss it. Then perhaps the thing to do is to agree to disagree and try to live with that. But I think that what Europe needs is a Cyprus which is, so to say, acting, seen to be acting for Europe as a whole. And my intervention stops, so we have 15 minutes, so I think we'll talk for questions. And I can imagine that there are some comments to what I said.